to talk, speak to attract them to anesthesiology and critical care. I must start off by saying we have a massive cadre projection for 2025. We only have about 158 at the moment. We have about 200 in training. So, and this is 2025. By the time you all come, it's going to be beyond that. And we will need a lot more anesthetists and critical care specialists for Sri Lanka. Anesthesia and critical care, I would say, is very different from other specialties. You are part of a multidisciplinary team, and it's a very vast field. The role is that you have to provide total patient care. During a surgery, you're the perioperative physician. So you're doing pre-op assessment, stratifying risk. You need to optimize patients. There are these new concepts called prehabilitation prior to the surgery to bring the patient to the best conditions possible. There are things called enhanced recovery. These, of course, we collaborate with the surgeons like Rani Fernando. And then the intraoperative management period and providing postoperative care. So you go on monitoring. Pain management is crucial, fluid and electrolyte balance, and hemodynamic support. You're also involved with resuscitation, life support. An anesthetist will always be there in the resus room of any trauma center. And we provide emergency care for most admissions in hospital, in obstetrics, managing patients with hemorrhaged, collapsed mothers, preeclampsia, eclampsia, and also in the forefront in managing sepsis. Again, pain management, acute pain during the perioperative period, following trauma, labor analgesia, and one of the new and very dynamic fields that's coming up is management of chronic pain. So bone, joints, soft tissues, cancers, neuropathy pain, all these pains. And I must tell you, that's becoming one of the most lucrative fields in anesthesiology all over the world. Care specialists. So they are involved with the emergency system support, all systems involved, ventilation, involved with monitoring, both invasive and non-invasive. And technology is so advanced nowadays, we are involved with a lot of physical things, physiological parameters being monitored with advanced technology. So you get a lot of training in these aspects. You're becoming very competent as much as the radiologists or somewhere near to them in ultrasound usage, providing renal support and taking a big role in nutritional support. Also, bearing in mind that we do have MD clinical nutrition trainees now, but we also complement to their work. So if you choose a career in anesthesia, you will work with patients at critical moments of their illness, and you're part of a multidisciplinary team. You are going to need a good knowledge in physiology, pharmacology, pathology, physics, anatomy. It's a diverse set of things. You learn a lot of general medicine, and you need to have knowledge in surgery, obstetrics. At least you need to know what the surgeons are up to. And you become confident in handling most emergencies and critically ill patients. Loads of technical skills. So you need, like Professor Rani Fernando said, the dexterity in your fingers. Again, this is a very trainable thing. You're handling airways. There's a lot of new technology, fiber optics, video laryngoscopy, doing front of neck access for tracheostomies, invasive lines, regional techniques. Most of these are nowadays ultrasound guided. We are seeing nerves that we have never seen before. We would have seen in the cadavers, but now we see them with the ultrasound, and we are accessing to block these nerves in a big way, and also doing echocardiography, lung ultrasound and things. So there are lots of things that is coming up with the technology advancements. So your skills are going to be utilized by all the departments of the hospital. You'll be in operating theaters, intensive care units, wards, trauma care centers, emergency units, radiology, radiotherapy, endoscopy units, psychiatry unit, where you are involved with providing ECT and in the labor wards for analgesia and for emergencies. Now, if you look at the training pathway, these are post-intern training where you start anesthesia. I know you have about 2 weeks to 1 month of training as a medical student, but beyond that, it's going to be a post-intern appointment. You'll have initial training in anesthesia and intensive care for 6 months. Following that, there are two pathways that you can follow. We do at the moment have a exam called the Part 1A, which is in basic anesthesiology, theory, and viva. One pathway is to go after 5 years of that to go into a what is called a certificate of competence in anesthesia, which enables you to get to grade one in the Ministry of Health. This is going to change to a 4-year structured program, and you're going to end up having what is called a PG certificate, postgraduate certificate in anesthesiology. I mean, the prospectus is still not out, but that's what it's going to be in a couple of years' time. The career grade way, you go into another exam called Part 1B, which is basic sciences. You do the exam in physiology, pharmacology, physics, and clinical measurements. Again, in the future, you will only have the Part 1B for your selection exam into PG training. Of course, the structure of it is going to slightly change from what it is now, but there will be only one exam. So you'll have training, the 6 months, you'll have some in-house assessments, and then get on to this selection exam. Your training period is about 2 years, 10 months, nearly 3 years. I would say that the Part 1B, the basic sciences exam, and that training period is the tough part in our career, right? But that's where you're beginning, and that's going to be quite tough. And then you go on to sit your final MD, which would, with further training, lead to board certification in anesthesia. Some people can have that. There will be post-MD people going into board certification in critical care medicine. For board certification critical care medicine, there are some trainees coming from medicine and some trainees going from anesthesia. Then you also can board certify in anesthesia with a special interest. The board, at the request of the ministry, are thinking of sub-speciality training as well. So we are thinking about board certification in pain management and board certification in cardiothoracic anesthesia at the moment. Nothing is finalized, but we are just thinking of doing the prospectuses at the moment. Overseas training, we've been in the PGIM training program from 1983. The MD in anesthesiology is recognized by the Royal College of Anesthetists in UK and the Royal College of Australia and New Zealand. The post-MD training posts are available to our trainees in UK, and you invariably post registrar posts, MTIs, or clinical fellow in the National Health Service of UK for 2 years. It's a little more difficult to get jobs in Australia, but UK, it's very, very easy. I always tell my trainees, have your IELTS and OET, and you can be in England immediately, right? It's always available, right? We have a high demand, very good centers. We have quite a few in Oxford, Cambridge, Guy's and St. Thomas's. So they are going to big places, and you can get good training in those places. And the important thing is you're exempted from the Part 1 of the Fellowship of the Royal College of Anesthetists, right? So once you go there, after 1 year of training in the UK, you can directly sit the final FRCA. You can also, if you're interested in the critical care medicine program, directly sit the final fellowship of the faculty of medicine and also the European diploma in intensive care. So that's an easy pathway for you to get added qualifications. If you look at the scope, the Colombo hospitals have recruited quite a few anesthetists into their hospitals. So even places like Kandy now is opening, the private sector is opening for anesthetists. You can be, if you take critical care as your specialty, you can easily go into these ICUs, right? And one of the important things that we still lack is a robust private sector pain management center, right? So I think as time goes on, that will come up. That's going to be, as I say, a very lucrative practice, right? So you have scope in the government, the Ministry of Health is going to be the main employing authority. Then the universities, some of the universities have anesthesia departments and they are slowly expanding. The armed forces is always on the lookout for qualified consultant anesthetists, and then also the private sector.